Starting a debugging session in TSO. Hi, I'm Dave Cole, president of Colesoft and chief architect of the ZXDC debugger. This video will show the basics of debugging either a program or a TSO command processor within TSO. Here's a clue. There ain't much difference. But first, let me give you a quick tip. If this is the first time you've watched any of these videos, please stop right now and take a moment to watch an introductory video first. It's called the ZXDC Training Video Viewing Tips. It's the 01 video in this series. Trust me, you'll be glad you did. Thanks. All right, let's get started. Generally, to set up a ZXDC debugging session in TSO, you need to run XDC call. This can be done either directly or via the ZXDC startup panel that we provide. If your needs are simple, you can just use XDC call directly. But the startup panel provides certain additional services, so you usually would prefer to use that instead. Here's an example of invoking XDC call directly. Simply provide the name of the program that you want to debug, followed by the params that it expects. Now, please notice that if your program needs datasets, you'll have to pre-allocate them with allocate commands. This is necessary regardless of whether you invoke XDC call directly or use the ZXDC startup panel. No difference. So if you're running frequent debugging sessions, you may want to create a CList or a RexExec to do the allocations. Anyway, let's press enter. And there you are. You are now in a debugging session for your program running in TSO. There's a lot going on here, most of which you're probably not real interested in, so I'll save that discussion for a later video. What you probably want most to do right now is check out your program. Okay, that's easy. Just type a where command at the top and press enter. And there it is, your program, in storage, already annotated with its source statements from your assembly. From here, you can do pretty much anything you like. Set breakpoints, step through execution, display data structures, change code and data, whatever. These are all topics that you will find in other videos. Before we go away from this, let me show you something cool. You see these two command lines? The first heads what we call the working window. This is where you enter most of your debugging commands. The second heads what we call a watch window. Watch windows contain information displaying command strings that are retained and are automatically re-executed every time you press the enter key. Watch windows are easy to create. I'm just going to move my cursor to whatever line I want to create a new watch window at and press function key 13. The new watch window is created at the cursored line. And its command line is populated with a copy of the next upper or next lower command line. Well, let's erase that and type in our own command to display the param field. It's kind of ugly, but here it is. So let's pretty it up a bit. Over here, I've got a script that does just that. It issues a bunch of equate commands to create a series of labels to identify the various parts of the param field. I've column aligned the various operands for readability, but that's not really necessary. Basically, the commands all provide a name and an address expression and various attribute operands. I'm not going to go into these at this time. You can read about them in the online help. Anyway, let's use the read command to run the script. And there you are. The parent field is all nicely formatted. Now let's use PF4 to blow out of here, and I'll show you how to use the XDC startup panel. Going to ISPF Primary. On our system, we use ZXDC quite a lot around here, so we've put its option D on our ISPF Primary menu. So let's type in a D and press Enter. Okay, this is our ZXDC startup panel. This panel divides down into two functional areas. ZXDC supports debugging programs either in the background or in TSO. This area pertains to debugging programs running in the batch, so in our case, we can ignore it completely. These fields pertain to debugging in TSO, and they offer a lot of useful services. To begin with, you can select whether you are debugging a TSO command processor or any other program that is not a command processor. Notice that this panel, when all is said and done, just invokes the XDC call program in various ways. XDC call can invoke a debugging session for either authorized programs or non-authorized programs, and for TSO command processor programs or for programs that are not command processors. This all occurs according to the name by which XDC call is invoked. XDC call has a total of four names, and they are XDC call for starting a non-authorized debugging session against a normal program, i.e. a program that is not a TSO command processor. XDC call A for starting an authorized debugging session against a normal program. XDC CMD for starting a non-authorized debugging session against a TSO command processor. XDC CMDA for starting an authorized debugging session against a TSO command processor. Just which name the startup panel uses depends upon the settings you make in the panel. For more information, see Help XDC Call. So let's take a look at what you can say in the ZXDC startup panel. Here is where you put the name of the program or command processor that you want to debug. If your program needs parm data, or your command processor uses command string operands, then put that information here. If your program or command is not yet located in any linklib, joblib, steplib, or task library, then put the names of the needed load libraries here. You could put up to six library names here. If you need more than that, then you will have to pre-allocate them to a DD-named TaskLib. Or if you prefer to use a different DD name, then place that DD name here. These fields are for debugging programs that themselves use ISPF services, but they are obsolete and should be left at no and TFS. If you need to debug an ISPF program or any other program that issues its own full screen displays to your TSO terminal, then you need to cause XDC to send its displays to a different terminal. See Help CDF TSO for how to do that. This field tells XDC call whether to set up a debugging session for an authorized or non-authorized program. If you say yes, then the panel will invoke either XDC call A or XDC CMDA. If you say no, then the panel will invoke either just XDC call or XDC CMD. Normally, when XDC call starts up, it first passes control to ZXDC so that you can load maps and set breakpoints before your program actually starts. But sometimes you don't need to do that. If you know, for example, that your program is going to abend right away, then you might want to wait until abend time before doing anything in ZXDC. So if you provide a yes here, then your program will start immediately, and you won't see ZXDC at all unless and until your program abends or hits a dead trap. Note, this field can also be used in correlation with the script DSN field. Stay tuned. This field applies only to non-authorized debugging sessions. The problem addressed here does not occur for authorized debugging. When ZXDC is used to debug in a non-authorized environment, it runs non-authorized. So it can zap and set breakpoints only in key 8 and key 9 storage. Normally, when the system loads a reentrant or refreshable program into storage, it loads it into fetchable key 0 storage. It does this because such programs, when properly written, never modify either their own code or their assembled-in data fields. So there is no need for them to reside in key 8 storage. So the system loads them into key 0 storage for integrity reasons. It protects the program, making it a little harder to corrupt. But this presents a problem for ZXDC, because in order to set breakpoints into a program, it needs to zap the program's code. But when XDC is non-authorized, it cannot zap key 0 storage. But if you say yes here, the system will be notified to load reentrant and refreshable programs into key 8 storage. And so the whole problem just goes away. Note, for authorized debugging, especially when debugging programs that change their execution keys away from key 8 to some other non-zero key, you almost always want to leave this field as no. Otherwise, OC4s will occur. Often when using ZXDC repeatedly to debug a program you're developing, you will find that you will be loading and reloading the same maps over and over again. In such cases, you might find it worthwhile to just put all these repetitive setup commands into a script. Then you can just run that script with a read command each time you start a new debugging session. Or you can place the script's file name here in this field, and it will be executed automatically. Note, if your script should end with a go command, then you might also want to set the quick start field to yes. Okay, so let's put all this new information to use. Just to be different, I'm going to demo debugging a TSO command processor. And I just happen to have one, a TSO command named schedule. This is the command string that I'm going to pass to it. Schedule needs to run authorized. So I'll put a Y here. And since schedule is a command processor, I'll put a 1 here to invoke XCC CMDA, and I'll press Enter. And here we are again. Execution is poised at the start of the schedule command. This is an authorized debugging session. The map that was autoloaded was a SIMData map. That's because I've not created ADATA for this program, only SIMData. So now if I issue a where command, I'll see where execution is at the start of my program. This, by the way, is what a SIMData map looks like. Just labels, no commentary or other assembler fluff. Also, no labels longer than 8 characters either. Sigh. Anyway, this debugging session was started with XDC CMDA, so R1 points to a command processor parameter list, a CPPL. Oh, I almost forgot. As far as the XDC call / XDC CMD program is concerned, the only significant difference between a normal program and a command processor is that upon initial entry, a normal program expects R1 to point to a PARM field, while a command processor expects R1 to point to a CPPL. If your program does not care what initial R1 points to, then it is irrelevant whether you use option 1 or option 2 when starting the debugging session. But in the current case, we are debugging a command processor that does care about initial R1. So let's take a look at the CPPL. Again, it's pretty ugly, but again, we can pretty it up. Here's a script for mapping the CPPL and the command buffer that it points to. It uses a dmap command to load a desect map for the CPPL, and a using command to assign it to the storage pointed to by R1. Now, the command buffer is a pretty simple object, so I'm just using equates instead of a map for that. Typing in a read command, and we see that the script has issued a dmap command to read the desect map for the CPPL, and issued a using command to place the map to where R1 points, and issued some equate commands to map out the command buffer. Okay, the CPPL is in view here, but not the command buffer. So let's take a look at that. And there it is. The cbuf equate labels the command buffer. The cbuf len equate labels the
buffer length field.
The cbuf z equate uses the cbuf len field to know where the end of the command buffer is. And the operands equate uses the cbuf OFFS field to know where the command operands start. All right, let's get back. And that's enough for now. If you have any comments or questions about this video or about anything else having to do with ZXDC, feel free to contact our staff directly. We can be reached at techsupport@colesoft.com or by phone at the number shown here. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you again soon. Bye-bye.